Kia ora and welcome to Tangata Pasifika. On tonight's show, our premier Pacific music event is under threat.
It is an economic possibility. These are hard times.
The new fitness craze that's now become a sporting event.
CrossFit started first as a functional strength and conditioning program, and then of course the sport's growing in leaps and bounds.
And we look at the future of Niue as its population dwindles.
Our challenge is to create an environment so that people can see that Niue offers them an opportunity just as much as New Zealand does, just as much as Australia does.
But first, some good news in tertiary education for Pasifika students. In the past, there's been high dropout rates with only a small percentage actually finishing their studies. As Tangalo Tele Osone Okesenia reports, this has changed, with more students making it through to graduation.
Graduating is an experience that many more Pasifika students are set to enjoy. Numbers of students completing their courses are up.
I've been in the tertiary sector a long time. I've waited for these moments. We've got 300 graduates that came out in April, although 379 is the greatest number we've had over the whole year. But 300 in April alone, we're yet to graduate again in September. Exciting.
Over the years, Unitech's implemented a Pacific strategy to get families and communities more involved. Giving Pasifika students assistance through the Pacific Centre has also been key, a space where they can have access to computers, internet and assistance from staff.
Good service from the staff when I need help, especially for my academic essays and stuff. I just come in to see Steve and the crew inside there. Yeah, they're very helpful.
As a Unitech graduate, Venusi is able to help support new students by sharing his journey and giving them some simple advice.
If they see us early, then we can usually catch them if they're going to fall out of the course. And we try reiterate to them it's just more hard work. The work, you don't have to be necessarily smarter than anyone else, you just got to just make those classes.
At the University of Auckland, they're seeing the same trend, higher numbers of Pasifika graduating and student enrolments.
The new Pacific students has increased by close to 30%. And that's the result of a fairly concerted and deliberate recruitment campaign by the university that is a result of number of years of initiatives, and we have quite a comprehensive strategy to not only recruit more Pacific students but also ensure that they succeed academically once they get here.
The pilot certificate in academic preparation is helping Pacific students on the fringe with their NCEA results to upskill and carry on to full university study. It's already showing its worth.
We had to go through summer school, and that really prepared us for semester one, because we actually got to go back to the studying environment, and then we kind of just stayed with that studying buzz, and then now we're still carrying it on, and it's really good.
It encourages us just to really push through, even though, you know, there's always gonna be those ups and downs. This program really just kind of lifts us up just to keep going, like to not give up.
And the results are looking good for Pasifika Level 2 NCEA. They're up 3.5% on the previous year. That's something that our communities can celebrate.
Tangalo Tele Osone Okesene visited Otahuhu College to find out what's generated these results.
Otahuhu College has suffered from negative stereotyping over the years, but the academic results on NCEA and scholarship level are telling a different story.
We're stereotyped a lot, and it's good to see that we're actually known now for achievement instead of failure.
It's a good feeling to see that many Pacific Islanders are passing NCEA Level 1 and 2 and 3, but not just the achievement but with a merit endorsement.
I congratulate each and every one of those young people and their whānau and family, āinga. A 3.5% lift in a 12-month period is significant, and it's significantly above trend.
It's not an overnight success for Otahuhu College. They've been preparing for these results with strategies like three-way conferencing, mentoring and special academies in trades, services and health sciences.
These academies, the standards are more rigorous, and we make sure that the students selected for these academies are able to surpass their own expectations.
I'm doing chemistry, physics and biology. I'm also taking English and as well as both maths, so statistics and calculus. So it's full-on academic course.
Besides the classroom, one of the keys to the school's success is having parents engaged in their child's learning.
I've had 100% turnout for parents coming to three-way conferences and also to parent meetings, and they've been 110% behind their child. So when they get the homework, they're getting it done. And if it's not done for any reason, we contact home.
You had that one-to-one session with your parent there next to the whānau teacher, you know, and it helps because you know exactly where you are and what you need to work on.
And that success has bred confidence in the students to reach for the stars.
I either want to be a paediatrician or a neurologist specialising in infants, but also working in our local hospital, Murumo Hospital, going back to the community.
Considering going into science in uni, possibly medicine at the University of Auckland.
I want to be an oncologist, so next year I want to study biomedicine at Auckland University, and that will be very hard to get into, but I know I can do it with the help of my friends and the teachers and the Health Science Academy.
New Zealand Music Month is here, which means we'll be celebrating our Pasifika artists with the Pacific Music Awards on the 30th of May.
But with the awards now in its 9th year, there are concerns it won't make it to its 10th. So Anake Aholele has this story.
Pacific artists on the New Zealand music scene just keeps growing bigger and better every year. But an event that matches their success comes at a price.
We've maintained a really good group of sponsors, but some haven't been able to maintain the level of money, so even though we've got them, we're running it less again.
The Pacific Music Awards cost around $70,000 to run, and without a major sponsor, its committee aren't denying that they've got a huge task ahead.
I think that we would be very short-sighted if we were not to be responsible about our role to the industry, to our communities and to the musicians.
The awards and its committee were established in 2004 to honour our artists after the Pacific category was removed from the New Zealand glitzy red carpet and music awards event, the Tuis. But Pacific artists continue to prove their place in the spotlight with successes such as Savage and more recently Aradhana, who signed a multi-album deal in the US at the end of last year.
I think of her as an artist. She's a musician, and her music is of high quality and high standard that no one should ever just close her in a box and say, oh yeah, she's a PI artist.
DJ Al Goody and Jandals of New FM radio station say the Pacific Music Awards is vital for all our artists, not just on the airwaves.
We have an event which is a live show, but we need television recognition as well. Give it prime time.
But without a naming sponsor, the committee says the event will continue to downsize.
The naming rights would just give us that extra, just to sort of be able to add some elements to the night and have some additional things covered that we can't do this year.
And that's why the Pacific Music Awards is such a unique gathering of musicians, families, communities. It's an acknowledgement of the industry, but even more importantly, remembering who we are, where we come from, and how our music uplifts the people in these hard times.
Uplifting sounds matched by financial help, they hope will keep the Pacific Music Awards alive.
Coming up after the break, how CrossFit is changing lives.
For me, it started off with the losing weight, but I needed something to keep me going, motivated, to keep that, losing that weight.
Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. Close to 4,000 Pacific people have made Northland their home. One is Samoan doctor Aniva Lawrence.
She and her physiotherapist husband Leroy bought their first medical clinic 3 years ago in Paihia. The couple have now opened their second practice in the region.
Sandra Kailahi travelled north to find out more.
Te Whare Ora o Tukipunga is a brand new clinic in Whangarei, and we're about to meet the new owners, starting with Samoan doctor Aniva Lawrence.
Oh, how are you?
Good, good.
Welcome to our new whare.
This is the reception area.
And we're coming through to our family room in here.
Okay.
So we really wanted a large room. We're hoping that kids can feel like they can come and do homework and stuff in here. And then this is our doctor's consultation room. Really set up for whole families to be able to come in and see us together.
And this is a second waiting area for us as well too. So
the little Pacific influence
there. And this is our podiatry room. So this is what makes us really in terms of an integrated family health centre.
What's behind this?
We're communicating with our local pharmacy group around setting up our own dispensary for our patients as well too. So when I talk about it to other people, I think I have that spark in my eyes. And when we blessed this on April the 6th, just the strong spirit that was present at that time, it confirmed to me that it was right.
The other owner is Aneva's husband, Leroy Lawrence. He's a qualified physiotherapist, so together they are able to offer a lot more and bring in other health services.
If we can prove that this model works and it can provide the quality of care which individuals and families need, then I hope that it is taken up and people start to bring that on board in their areas.
If we can inspire younger professionals that are coming through to have the drive to do this themselves, then I think that'll be an achievement for us. So.
Te Whare Ora is the couple's second clinic. In 2009, they bought a small established practice in Paihia. Some of her patients include Māori and Samoan families, like Taunaha Smith, who has four boys. Little Jamie has been diagnosed with leukaemia.
I think it's awesome, especially for this community. I mean, we are predominantly Māori in this community, but to have someone Pacifica here and having a practice in Paihia, I think it's great for the community as a whole.
I often can recognise patients that have connections, and it is good to engage with all of our Pacific people. I understand when they're talking about palusami or boil up, and I know what those things are. I've had them myself, you know. It's had them too much at times, but other than that, it's a wonderful thing to have those connections with our patients locally.
The couple moved from Auckland to the north 8 years ago, and the decision has paid off.
We would probably have stayed comfortable in Auckland working for other people, and it wouldn't have challenged us to think outside the square.
The new clinic in Tikipunga is starting to pick up. They've signed up over 400 clients in a month, and the Paihia clinic is running well. With three boys and two businesses, the Lawrences have had their hands full, but they're not complaining.
It's been hard work, and I think the hard work has definitely paid off. When we created the service, I see it not just for my generation, but for the generations to come. And so I see a place that's that my children can have pride in.
To sport now, it's called CrossFit, an exercise craze that's taken off in gyms, paddocks and fitness centres around the country over the past few years.
Touted as a functional exercise regime, CrossFitters have their own competitions throughout the country where it's taken off as a sport. We checked out one such games in Auckland and found a handful of PIs loving the challenge. John Ortunga has the story.
They swam, they lifted, they climbed rope. All shapes and sizes.
You got big, small. I mean, it's really good for the community and really good for the whole CrossFit scene as a whole, you know. So
it's meeting other people, like other Pacific Islanders, you know, different cultures, and just watching people improve as they go along.
This is the CrossFit HPU Playoffs, a team's competition run out of a city gym. It's open to everyday competitors as well as elites.
We thought it was an opportunity to develop as a club, to put on events and to showcase our facility here at Les Mons. Yeah, well, our first event, basically we only had 16 teams, and because we look after the athletes and because we've listened to what the comments that came back in regards to feedback, we've gone to 55 teams.
The playoffs kicked off at 6 a.m. with burpees and a 50-metre swim. Not everyone taking it in their stride.
An Islander's strength, is it? You can tell in the pool because everyone who was last was an Islander.
Auckland Breakfast radio host Tash Yedemir and teammates had trained for this event but found it tough on the day.
You can do as many rope climbs as you can or like do as many power cleans as you can, but once you put it all together and you're at an actual competition, totally different story.
In the juniors, Jessica Asi was putting in the hard yards.
It's fun. People see CrossFit as it's hard out, elite, but no, it's not. You start at the top level and they'll work you up to elite.
And in that elite or RX division with a zealous CrossFit team from West Auckland.
I'm starting to cramp up a bit, but that's where the mobility comes in, so just rolling out, getting prepared for the next workout.
I wanted to do kind of well in the snatch and the weightlifting competition, and I really like rope climbs. I'm a bit of a monkey, so I like that. And I want to do some handstand push-ups.
What all the competitors have in common is a love of a sport that's made huge inroads in recent years. And one of its finest exponents is Darren Ellis.
CrossFit started first as a functional strength and conditioning program, and for me, that's still what I hold dear more than anything, because it helps people change their lives, helps them move better, helps them be healthier and fitter and stronger. And then of course the sport's growing in leaps and bounds, and that's just a phenomenal way for people, I guess, to take that next step and to test themselves at another level.
And Pacific people are taking the sport in their stride. The health benefits are obvious.
For me, it started off with the losing weight, but I needed something to keep me going, motivated, to keep that, losing that weight. So I thought, if I do competitions, it's a goal for me.
It's like an all-over body thing. You know, you're not just lifting weights and running, you know, you're doing everything. So yeah, definitely good for the PIs, I reckon.
And there's plenty to test our top athletes.
The results are measurable, so you know how well you're doing, and it's individual, but you're working in a team or community, and I'm fitter than I ever was.
After all, that's the name of the game.
Wow, you guys look fantastic. I think I'd better go along to CrossFit myself. Anyway, time now for community notices, brought to you with the track Tonight by Drew featuring Tyree.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah, Tyree. I've been waiting all week, but tonight is here now. I got something we can roll up and share around. Drink in my cup, time to get my saddle on. And we can party like they did back in Babylon. I give a fuck about tomorrow, so everybody popping up the bottle. Cause we gon' live it up tonight, like it's my last. So take a picture, man, and just coast, let's go.
Tonight, let's get away and throw all of our problems into yesterday. Let's pretend for a moment.
After the break, with the majority of New Wayans living in New Zealand, what does the future hold for the Rock of Polynesia?
It's a sad thing. A living community must have people to live. What will happen to Niue? What will happen to Niue?
Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika. We're back in Niue this week to look at the issues threatening the Rock of Polynesia.
Depopulation has been a major concern for the tiny island. There are over 20,000 Niueans living in New Zealand compared to around 1,500 people who remain on the rock.
For years, Niueans have left their homeland for work, education and other opportunities. John Pulu was in Niue to find out who will stay and who will go.
A living community must have people to live. It's a sad thing at this moment when I come to think of it, I go to sleep, I always have that in mind. Now, what will happen to Niue? What will happen to Niue?
In order for a community to continue to thrive, it needs people. And people are the ones that continue the culture, the language, everything. So that's our main taonga, is our people.
For one of the smallest countries on Earth, Niue's biggest problem is keeping people here. In a place that's big on beauty but small on population, keeping afloat is tough.
Our challenge is to create an environment so that people can see that Niue offers them an opportunity just as much as New Zealand does, just as much as Australia does. They might be slightly different, but at the same time, I'd like to enable us to show not just those people who are staying here, but those people living overseas, hey, we can do this in my own country, and we can live quite comfortably in my own country.
It's a romantic idea that today few are buying into. These lifeless boxes are a reminder of better days.
There are around 200 to 300 abandoned homes here in Niue. This is just one of them. Most are home to vegetation, rubbish, and even pests. For now, what this island needs is a lifeline so that one day, these homes are filled again. There are the Hati, however, like Inangaro Wakaafi, who have decided to do what they can for their homeland.
Have you ever thought about moving overseas?
It has crossed my mind from time to time that there may be greener pastures out there, but I've got a job here in Niue and I've got everything that I need or want. And in terms of education, a lot of our young people leave for New Zealand to get further with their education. But I've found that the internet is actually really, really good, and I'm actually studying and working here in Niue. So yeah, it's not really an issue for me, but I like the lifestyle in Niue. That's the main thing that keeps me here.
Should I stay or should I go? To attract people to stay, Niue needs jobs. Just another thing this place is short on. Aid money is the economy's life support. New Zealand injects $10 million a year. On their own, Niue scrapes together $250,000 per annum, with taro, honey and noni juice the big export earners. Niue's economy was dealt a blow last November, with Reef Shipping placed into receivership, putting the Niue government's joint ventures with the group's fish factory and Noru Farm in limbo. This disaster joins a long list of failed projects the ROC has encountered over the years, from passion fruit juice, vanilla and even alpaca quarantine. Even so, the man in charge is not giving up. He's got more plans, including digging up their own backyard to bring more employment and export earnings.
We know there's something down there. We're in the process of negotiating final, if you like, explorations, and then determining what the commercial arrangements will be after, and if we discover something down there. Gold and copper, the two main things that we're talking about here.
While those in power worry about the running of the country,
Hafeiki Vilitama.
Malolelei.
Oh, whakalofalahi atu.
Whakalofalahi mahaki atu.
North of Alofi, the Ulumutua o Mutalau is just as concerned for his island.
Do you fear for the future of Niue?
Like, coming to think of it deeply, like people, take New Zealand for instance, it's not the Maoris who are living there first, it's not the Maoris today, it's all sorts of people living in New Zealand. And this may be the future of Niue. Niue could be another island for other people to live in.
One of those people who now call Niue home is Israeli entrepreneur and the president of the Chamber of Commerce, Avi Rubin.
Everything is here. It's a microcosmos. And the satisfaction you get, because in a small place, you can make an impact that helps everybody.
Avi's mission is similar to his biblical-themed boat. He's here to help save Niue.
Develop businesses, make sure that people here are running a good, profitable business. In the end of the day, less dependency on aid. Create our own future. And we can do it, and we believe that, I believe that with tourism development, there's many opportunities here for the people to start or grow their businesses.
And these opportunities will take time to grow, but for now, the Premier is asking his people to come back home.
I want Niue to remain virtually as it is, and to invite people to come and share it with us. Who can afford to come and share it with us and help us pay to sustain ourselves?
I have a lot of faith in this generation and a lot of the bridges that have been built between our communities here on the island and those abroad. I know that somehow we will continue. And the internet is one way of keeping our people together.
I'm happy living here as a Niuean. And I always be proud to say, to tell who I am, from the top of my head here down to my soles, I am a Niuean. I'm proud to say I am a Niuean.
Well, before we go, we'd like to pay tribute to a pioneer in the Tongan community in Auckland. Mele Satua Lavolo, or Satua as she was fondly known, died on Monday night.
96-year-old Satua came to New Zealand in the early 1950s with her husband Te Vita. She helped set up the United Church of Tonga on Richmond Road in the 1970s. She was a former president of Queen Salote Old Girls Association in New Zealand and was a pioneering Pacific businesswoman. Rest in peace, Mele Satua. Well, that's our show for this week. Join us again next week when John Utanga reports on Film Raro in the Cook Islands.
We look forward to your company then. Remember, you can catch all our stories and find out what's happening in the community online at tvnz.co.nz, keyword Tangata Pasifika. On Facebook, just like us, and we're on YouTube as well. Take care till fast before.
And remember, Dads, it's Mother's Day on Sunday, so happy Mother's Day. Mālua o pito.